Welcome to First Federated Church's online video podcast of this week's sermon. First Federated Church is based out of Des Moines, Iowa. Please visit www.firstfederated.org for more information.
Build your kingdom here, let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire, win this nation back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom. Come here, we pray.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope and light.
Strength and love of Christ.
We
Let's stand together on this third and final stanza as we join the choir. Great is thy faithfulness. Good morning, First Federated Church. Welcome to the celebration of your 100th birthday. Now, I've got to admit, I've not been around too many people who have made it to 100, but you look pretty good for 100. Yeah. Yes, I hope to look as good as you do when I get to be 100. And that's a long ways off. But anyway, welcome to our service today. We're excited that you're here. We've been looking forward to this day. Last night over in West Des Moines at the Hy-Vee Conference Center, we gathered with about 350 people who are both present Federites and former Federites. They're in the Old Testament, you know, right beside the Hivites, the Jebusites, and the Federites. They were friends of Israel, you know. But anyway, we gathered over there, had a wonderful time of just fellowshipping and meeting new people, renewing old friendships. It was a great time, and we're expecting that today will be no less whatsoever. When you came in this morning, you should have received a bulletin with our 100th anniversary crest on it. That looks like a great keepsake to hold on to, but it'll tell you all that you need to know about what's coming up this coming week at First Federated Church. Especially there, the little block on the front page gives you all of the vital information that you need to know about, because we've got a lot of things going on as we continue on through the summer. So you'll want to make sure you take a look at that and be ready to serve and be part of the different ministries that are taking place. If you are a regular, we're excited to see you here today. If you used to be a regular here at Federated, we're glad to have you back. And we would invite you to become a regular again, you know. Maybe you live in Texas now and it'd be a little bit tough for you to be a regular again. But nonetheless, the invitation is always there. But if you're a first-time worshiper with First Federated Church, we're so glad that you wandered in and that you're part of our service today. At the end of the service, my wife and I will be in the foyer, and we'd love to just get a chance to meet you. So if you are a first-time worshiper, come back there, introduce yourself, and we'll make your acquaintance. Now, today we have a lot of special guests, and I can't recognize all of them, but we do want to take just a moment to name the folks who have served here at First Federated Church, either as a pastor, associate pastor, or a support staff individual, and we have quite a few. So what I want to do at this time is I'm going to read off some names with the positions that these names fall under, and when you hear your name, if you'll just stand and remain standing, and then congregation, let's just hold our applause until the end, and then we'll recognize all of those who are our special guests today. Serving as former senior pastors or associate pastors are Tom Allen, his wife Judy, Peter Bergen, Don Morris and his wife Nancy, Roger Poupart, Michael Mudloff and his wife Sasha. Also serving in the position of youth pastors or children's directors John Dilley and his wife Jennifer, Jane Larson and her husband Scott, Brett Starr and his wife Tammy, Ty Thomas and his wife Allison, and Josh Halling and his wife Emily. Serving in the media ministry, Gary Wabshaw and his wife Jody. Serving in support is Pat Anderson. Now, those are the folks who have served here and gone on to other ministries or other communities. Here are past staff members who are still worshiping here at Federated. Bob Kennedy, these are business administrators. Bob Kennedy, Tom Hefner and his wife Erin, Jan McCourt and her husband Mike, youth ministry, Rick Lee and his wife Charlotte, facilities management, Lamar Myers and his wife Priscilla, compassion ministry, Chuck Underwood, admin assistants, Ginger Jones and her husband Jeff, Helen Phillips, Diana Philpott and her husband Rich, Nada Reeve and her husband Herman, and Mary Tesser and her husband Mike. I hope I've gotten everybody. If not, I'm sorry. But let's give these folks a round of applause. We sincerely thank you for your service, your contributions here at the church, and we wish God's very best on you as you're continuing to serve Him in whatever capacity that you presently do. Right now, we're going to watch a video together. Two couples, one who has been a part of Federated for more than 50 years, the second, less than five. And it's interesting to hear their perspectives. And we gain a lot of knowledge about the ministry of the church and its impact through these videos. So let's turn our attention now to the screens and take a look at these videos.
When I was real young, my mother used to bring me to Federated. Then we didn't. We didn't go to church for a while. My great aunt used to come and spend a few weeks with us every summer. And I would walk with her up to Federated. And I went to Federated with her. And during that time, I received Christ as my Savior.
This is what my mother received about the new baby welcoming me to Federated and to the cradle roll. And then on my first year anniversary, I received another postcard congratulating me on being a year old in the cradle roll and the 2 year old. And they were all addressed to Nada Kathleen Morrell and three. My third birthday, I got one of those. So that was really special.
My dad was an Easter Christmas Christian. Earlier in his life, he was really a pretty good Christian. He started a church and everything else. And then he put his eyes on an evangelist who failed him. And that blew my dad out of the water. And he would say, "Oh, I know all about these great Christians." And it taught me something, that you can't put your eyes on flesh. Flesh will always fail you. And I've preached that through the years to a lot of people. And I said, "Don't put your eyes on me. Put your eyes on Christ, and Christ will never fail you."
I'm Adam Fasalius.
And I'm JC Fasalius.
And we've been coming here to First Federated for about 5 years now.
5 years.
We were neighbors before we were more than neighbors. And we first started coming here because a pamphlet was slipped under
My door.
Her door.
Mm-hmm.
So ever since then, we've been coming. We kind of keep coming back because we just really love the staff around here. We think they do a great job. We think Mike does a great job with his sermons every week. And me personally, I'm from Dubuque, so I'm a recovering Catholic. And which means for the first time, I came to a church. The first time we came here, we were a couple minutes late, and I asked her, is it going to be okay that we're late? Like, I was nervous that people were going to be looking mm-hmm. at us. So it was kind of refreshing to come for the first time and see people wanting to be here. And for the first time, I had something every week that I got from the sermon that I could work on myself, and that was it was great. So
the other cool thing about it being just slipped under my door in the apartment complex is Pastor Mike and Danny have been talking about canvassing the neighborhoods and just talking to people about getting out and things like that. And that's also really important because you might not think that that flyer, that people are really receptive to that. But I mean, we've been coming here for the last 5 years just because of that. So it's good to get out there too and help out as well.
Sure, it works. Mm-hmm. Since we've been here, we've seen a lot of growth in the church. We've seen a lot of ways that God's been remained faithful. A couple years ago, we saw them burn the deed because mm-hmm. they had finished paying off the debt,
yep.
Which is great. And they did that years early, I believe. So it's great to see God remaining faithful in that respect.
Mm-hmm. And then just the addition of the 9:45 service, because the 11 o'clock service is overflowing. That's always a good problem to have, and that's something that we've been able to see while we're here as well. I think that we see the church going in the direction of just reaching out to the
3-1-0-1-1 window.
Yep, thank you. Those two windows in the local community and then branching out more around. So I think that that's pretty much the direction it's going. And that's exciting
sure.
to see.
Sure, very exciting. Stuff. And we're proof that it works. Mm-hmm. So who knows whose door you're knocking on.
Yeah.
I like that comment, we were neighbors before we were more than neighbors. And I'm amazed, Nada, wherever you are, I know you're here, but keeping those documents from all the way back then, that was amazing. Well, a lot of memories, huh? And I know that you're filled with them, and new ones are being made all the time. Well, right now, we're going to have an opportunity to hear from some of the former pastors who serve First Federated Church. And we have three on hand this morning that are going to share with you live, one that's going to be doing so by video. So I'm going to ask Don Morris and Tom Allen, if you'll go ahead and come to the platform right now. You're going to be the first two to lead off. And then we're going to have we're going to worship together. And then we'll hear the other two, which will be Paul Nyquist. He'll be by video. And then Roger Poupart. Just want to tell you guys that this morning we have a sniper in the balcony, and if you go 1 second past 5 minutes, you're going on to glory today. All right? Yeah. Welcome.
I have a vest on, so go ahead and shoot, because I'm going to talk. So good to see you all, be with you. Last night was just a wonderful time, and I had a chance to talk about Tom a little bit last night because they let me do something funny. Today I'm going to do something very serious, but I got to do something funny. And if you weren't here, go to your social media, hashtag Pastor Fallen and Can't Get Up. And
it
was very funny. Just ask them. Let me give you some background. I am a preacher's son, so I was raised in a pastor's home my entire life. And what I'm going to share with you today, I've debated whether I should or not, because it's walking to an edge. And yet, to answer the question, what has God taught me the most? I have to go to this thing, but as a pastor's son, my dad and mom would always talk about any church split is the worst thing that can ever happen. It's just the most painful thing that can ever happen. And I'd hear mom and dad talk about a pastor that had a church split or a congregation that hadn't been able to get over a split. And so I was raised with that. And then you go to Bible college and they say never get in a church split. And at 1990, as you all know, we had a very difficult church split. Very emotional time, very difficult time. Five of us on staff had aught with leadership, and we went through the Matthew 18 process and could not resolve it, and couldn't have the help to get it resolved. And so I remember some of those elder meetings that would go to 2 or 3 in the morning, trying to put it together, just going to happen. Finally, the elders came down with a ruling that things shouldn't change, and the five of us, I remember meeting in my office, said we feel we can no longer serve under this leadership, and so we gave our resignations. As I said, very painful. Thursday night, went home, had a daughter, Abby, back there that was just 2, and the rest of the kids, and told Nance, and praise God for a wife who has more faith than I have at times, but she said we will be okay. So that was late Thursday night. All day Friday, I was getting boxes ready and getting a trailer ready and a friend ready. And at 11 o'clock at night, under the shame of moving everything out of my office after 20 years, I moved over 3,000 books out, all my stuff, and moved it all home. And Friday night was a very difficult time as I left the doorway over there knowing that I wouldn't be coming back in. Saturday, put my office together, sat and talked with Nance, what was I going to do, and am I going to go back to school and get another degree, like I need another degree? Do I want to go in commercial now? What do I want to do? Do I want to become a businessman? And couldn't really figure it out, but in the back of my mind, I had a feeling that Sunday morning, when the resignations were read and it would be told, that there would be such a swell of support that, the board would have to say, no, we can't do this, we need to do something else. So Sunday morning, as a pastor, you know moment by moment what's going to happen at each different time after each, when's this service starting and when's that service starting. And in my mind, I was convinced that whenever the announcement was made around 12 o'clock, that there would be such an outpouring of love that our street would be flooded with cars. In fact, honest truth, I thought of letting the Urbandale police know that they'll probably need a policeman here to direct traffic because we live on a very narrow street. 12 came, 12:15 came, gave people some time, 12:30 came. I'm out next to our house. We had just bought an investment property and I was cleaning it up because I didn't know what else to do. And I was just waiting. Every car that go by, I was just waiting. I was waiting for the parking lot of our house to be filled up, and it never was. Around 2 o'clock, a very old car pulled up. And an African-American man got out that I barely knew. His name was Robert. And I had helped his wife in counseling, and he in counseling, but that's all I knew of him. Got out of his car, came over to me, and embraced me. And he said, Pastor, I was at the service today, and he said, I have no idea what to say to you, but I do know that I need to be here by your side. Robert and I worked. I gave him a rake, and we worked for quite a while. And then he said, Pastor, I have to leave, gave me another hug. I remember putting my head on the pillow that night and saying, God, where were you? The lesson that I have learned that I would like to share with you today is that my lowest, darkest, most difficult moment in ministry, when I felt all alone and I said, Lord, where were you? The face of Robert smiling and embracing me came back as if God was saying, Don, at your lowest, I love you the most. I'm the closest to you. You're my beloved child. That's the lesson that I learned. Thank you, Federated Family, for 20 years of serving you. Nance, when we got home last night after grilling me about Tom and whether that story was true or not, said, you know, it felt like home. And I said, honey, it felt like home. Thank you, family. It's a joy to be with you.
My name's Tom Allen. Those were hard. That was a hard time, Don recounted, and it's really a good time because it's part of the history of a family. 100 years. You have your ups and your downs, and I want you to know we've had ours. We've worked together for 36 years. and then a couple of times not working together. But man, has it been great. And you don't expect everything to be just perfect. You expect God to be perfect and to lead you through whatever comes your way. That's what he's done the history of this church for 100 years. That's what he's done in our lives. Now I want you to know Don and I love each other very much. We are very much reconciled. And we have meals together and watch Gaither together and do all kinds of things and have been serving together. So we praise God for that. Now, evidently, that was kind of therapeutic for Don. So as therapy for me to make up for last night, I just wanted you to know that after the service, I know the sniper's ready. I see him aiming. After the service was over, I was able to get Don's wheelchair and his oxygen and help him out. And so it was just a real, I felt good about that, even though he had torn me to shreds. So, but I love you, brother. I also want you to know right off the bat that I am not one of the founding pastors of this church, okay? Even though it might appear that. But we had 25 wonderful years here, and not always easy, but wonderful. And I just wanted to recount one thing that is characteristic of the history of this church. As I watched the videos last night, and I saw what God has done. There have been times where this church was on top and then struggled and on top and struggled. And right now, God is blessing, and I'm so happy and so thankful. And I remember a Saturday night in June of 2070. I remember a June. It's a long time ago. And as a founding pastor, you forget, you know? I remember in June of 1970, the first year Don and I had the privilege of being pastors here, on a Saturday night, we had gone over to La House Pizza over on, 14th Street, South 14th Street East. And we had had pizza, and we were coming back, and we stopped by what is now a building, a state building, but they had open-air tent revivals. And we stopped there, and wanted to see it. It was kind of a Pentecostal event. We'd never stopped at anything like that before. And we saw one of our young men from Federated and three of his hippie friends. You got to know, in 1970, no church in Des Moines welcomed the hippies. And we met Steve Ford there and then his three friends, Larry Funk and Doug and Charlene Dietrich. And we loved them and treated them very well and said, why don't you come to church tomorrow? And Steve said, I'm going to invite them, I'm going to ask them, and I'm going to bring them. And you got to know, no church allowed hippies in those days. They were just kind of the outcasts. And they hadn't been infederated. And that next morning, those four hippies came to our church. And instead of sitting up in the balcony where they would not be seen and where they should have sat, they were right in the second row, right down front. And they sat there and seemed to enjoy the service. And we were praying for them. We welcomed them. We're so happy. But I will never forget what happened after that service. And it's what brought 20 years of revival in this church. The event that took place next. Because when I finished praying and the service was over, two elderly ladies in their 70s or 80s, Edna Royer and B. Schaefer, came over to those four hippies and gave them the biggest hugs and welcomed them and loved them and told them how happy they were that they were there. And I can tell you that blew those kids' minds. And the next Sunday, two rows were full of hippies. Instead of sitting where they should have, they were down front. And within months, we had hundreds and hundreds of hippies. And then their lives got changed. The church started growing, went from 325 to over 1,000 in just a period of 2-3 years. And then it started growing again because the parents started coming, because what they couldn't do with their kids, God was doing. And their lives were just being changed. And within 5-6 years, the church was running 1,900 people every Sunday, three services, and just unbelievable. And it's all because God used the spirit of this church. See, people had been praying for 2 years that God would do something at Fed. And he did. He heard those prayers and used those two dear ladies who are today with the Lord, but marvelous Christian witnesses, to love those people who came. They felt so welcomed that they wanted everybody to come, and they invited half the city. And it was amazing what God did. And I remember that as one of the multitude of witnesses and testimonies of what God has done through your lives. So many of you right here were part of that. And I thank you for the privilege of allowing myself, my wife, Don, and Nancy, and so many of us to be a part of that great work of God. So as we look at the next 100, expect even more. Expect even better, because God's up to that, I believe.
Thank you. Let's stand together.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. Above all things, His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With my hand and an outstretched arm, His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, His love endures forever.
take a seat.
Good morning to everyone at First Federated Church. For those of you whom I've never met, my name is Paul Nyquist, and I had the awesome privilege of serving as the pastor of Federated from 1996 to 2001. And with all those who have gone on before me and those who have followed me, I want to offer my heartiest congratulations on this special centennial celebration weekend. One thing I know you have been especially celebrating is the faithfulness of God to this church. And while my 5 years with you represents just a tiny part of your 100-year history, I clearly saw God's faithfulness. For those of you who go back over 20 years with the church, you know that the early 90s for Federated were a little bit like a Charles Dickens novel. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. So when I first set foot in the pastor's office in November of 1996, we were facing some significant challenges, some financial, some spiritual, some relational. But here's the good news. God didn't allow the ministry to crumble. The elders and deacons pulled together and stayed together. And God allowed us to rebuild our ministry staff. You, the committed members of the church, gave generously. And we ended every budget year with a balanced budget, the bills paid, missionaries supported, and some needed repairs of the church completed. In many ways, that probably shouldn't have happened, but it did. Why? Because our God was faithful. You have 100 years of stories like that. And you can tell those stories because that is the character of our God. Great is His faithfulness. Thank you for letting me be a small part of your history. That's a privilege I always will cherish. I'm so disappointed I could not be there to share in the celebration, but prior plans with Moody already had me out of the country. I still pray for you and the pastoral staff every week. And my prayer is that our God will continue to amaze you with His faithfulness until His Son returns in the sky to take us home. Congratulations on 100 years.
Well, many of you have gotten chain letters before, and I saw an unusual one that was for ministers. And it said, this one doesn't cost you any money, but what you need to do, it was written actually to the congregation, it said, there's a list of churches here that are looking to change pastors. And they said, what we want you to do is to bundle up your pastor and to send him to the church at the bottom of the list. And it says, in 6 weeks, you'll get about 1,000 pastors, and one of them should be worth keeping. Then it said, warning, one church broke the chain and they got their old pastor back. I don't know what y'all did because you got 3 of your old pastors back this week. But you have a wonderful pastor. Both Mike and Connie, who are here, have been so faithful over the years. And just like Pastor Paul, I am standing on the shoulders. Paul was standing on the shoulders of Don and Tom, and I'm standing on the shoulders of what Paul did. And there are so many things that I saw. We were told to talk about the faithfulness that we saw God do in our time of ministry here. I could talk about facility renovations. I could talk about lives that were changed. I could talk about so many ways that we did see God being faithful. But really what I want to just focus on this morning are the people of Federated, because that is what a church is. It's not the building, it's not even the pastors, because the role of a pastor in Ephesians 4 is to equip God's people for God's work, and that's what the pastoral team, that's what so many of you who are faithful members of Federated have done for more than 100 years, and it's why this church is here for 100 years. Very few churches make this milestone, and of those that do, very few are thriving and sharing God's word like First Federated Church is doing, which is why its lampstand has not gone out for 100 years. I want to have you take a test this morning. It's not going to be graded. You don't need pen or paper. I just want you to think about this in your mind. If I were to ask you to name the last five Heisman Trophy, five Heisman winners, some of you might be able to do it, but others of you are pulling out your phones right now, Googling that to find out who they are. If I were to ask you to name the last 10 Nobel Peace Prize winners, the same thing, you probably struggle to do it. If I were to ask you to name the five wealthiest people in the world, few of you could do it. And on the list goes of things I could ask you to remember. And few of you would remember that, because in time, fame fades, the applause diminishes, trophies tarnish. But if I were to have the test go something like this, and I were to say to you, I want you to name five people who impacted your life for good. If I asked you to name teachers that were significant in your life, that taught you some life lesson that changed you. If I were to ask you to think of somebody who was there in a dire time of need for you. If I were to ask you to name the person who led you to the Lord or helped you grow in your walk with the Lord, many of you would have no problem at all making a long list of those names, because that's what matters. The people who impact our lives, it's not fame, it's not wealth, it's not significance, awards, or degrees on the wall that matter. It's people who touched your life and changed your life. And First Federated Church is full of that. Full of people who have touched your lives. If I were to ask you to name some significant lesson you've learned in and through this church, all of you could do that. And that's why First Federated Church is here for 100 years. It's why First Federated Church will continue to see its greatest days ahead under Pastor Mike and the man who will one day replace him if the Lord doesn't return and take us all home at the rapture soon. And so as you look at this church, I want to thank each of you for the part you've played in the past, and the part you're playing now in this great church and impacting this world for the gospel of Jesus Christ. I want to close with this verse from Philippians. It's out of Philippians chapter 1, and it says, I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, always offering prayer with joy in my every prayer for you all, in view of your participation in the gospel from the first day until now. Thank you, First Federated Church, for your faithfulness. Thank you for the privilege I've had of being a part, a small part of some of your lives, and seeing God impact and change you as he did me in and through this church. God bless you all.
Let's stand together as we continue our time of worship and celebrating God's faithfulness. Even though I walk casting out fear, and even when you're caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back. I know you are near, and I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me,
to never let go. And every high and every low.
Lord Jesus, this morning is a testimony to your greatness and your goodness and your faithfulness. We lift up our thanks, our praise, our gratitude for all you have chosen to do here through many administrations and the stewardship of many people. God, allow us to continue to be faithful to you. As we receive our morning offering this morning, Lord, we thank you for the way you faithfully use the gifts of your people to sustain this ministry and to grow the gospel as it has gone literally out to all the corners of this earth. We pray also that you'll continue to compound the gifts that are given here and allow us to have an incremental impact in bringing your gospel to people who do not yet know, as well as those in the 10-11 window who need to know as well. We thank you for this. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please take a seat.
Whenever you're ready for an intro.
Faithful. Forever you are faithful, Father to the fatherless. You uphold the one who feels forsaken. You are faithful, God. Faithful. You are faithful, lover of the wounded heart. You defend the poor and the forgotten. You are faithful, God. And I will sing to the Maker on heaven. You reign forever. and your love will endure. Faithful and true is the name of the Lord. You are faithful, God. You are faithful.
In the early 1900s, Northwest Des Moines was an agricultural area of dairies, fruit and truck farms, a few small acreages, and a coal mine at 34th and Urbandale Avenue. The population of the area, which was known as Urbandale, grew rapidly. The need for a church in Urbandale became evident. On May 27, 1914, a prayer meeting was held, and the Reverend Lockhart was asked to take the lead in organizing a Union Church. And the first building, the Tabernacle, was raised on the corner of Beaver and Adams by the men of the church in just 2 days. The first service was held there on June 21, 1914. The church, known as Urbandale Federated Church, was formally organized on June 28, 1914. In September of 1914, ground was broken for a new church building on the same lot. By April of 1920, the superstructure of that first permanent building was completed and proudly clear of debt. Several pastors served this growing congregation during the early years. Reverend Clifton Rash, who served from 1922 to 1938, is perhaps the best remembered. The church was renamed First Federated Church in 1929. First Federated has welcomed many well-known preachers and evangelists, Bible teachers, and missionaries. In 1947, the Ladies' Aid and Circle groups were organized into the Women's Association, emphasizing Bible study, service, missions, and fellowship. The Reverend Alan Brown served until 1958, when Pastor Onesimus Rundus came and First Federated continued to grow. In the early 60s, we were bulging at the seams. Thus began the Program of Progress, a 4-year goal to raise $160,000 for the addition of a Christian education wing, which was completed in 1964. In 1967, Peter Bergen came to the church as assistant pastor, but was later called upon to stand in the gap as senior pastor when Pastor Rundus moved to another pastorate in Evanston, Illinois. On New Year's Eve of 1969, Tom Allen and Don Morris, two young and single men, presided over their first service at First Federated. Federated became known as the church that welcomed hippies and who flocked in on a weekly basis with their long hair, bare feet, and sweet spirits. Soon, a Vietnamese church was established within our building and was a blessing to us for the next 24 years. Come Together, our weekly Sunday service, began airing on WHO television and reached thousands over the next few years. On February 5, 1980, the former Franklin Junior High, located on 4801 Franklin Avenue, became the official property of First Federated Church. Services were first held in January of 1981. On September 16, 1984, groundbreaking was held for a new 4,200-seat sanctuary. The first services were held here on Easter Sunday, April 19, 1987. After more than 20 years of ministry at Federated, both Pastor Tom and Don felt God's calling to move on to other ministry pursuits. God remained faithful to Federated and brought Dr. Paul Nyquist to pastor in 1996. He was an excellent Bible teacher, drawing many new people to hear his preaching. In May 2002, a tall Texan and former police officer named Roger Poupart was called as our new senior pastor. In October 2006, Pastor Mike Rose came from Albany Baptist Church in Athens, Ohio. God has given him a renewed vision for the 50310-50311 neighborhood with our new vision of love God, love people, make disciples. 100 years ago, a neighborhood saw a need and filled that need by building a church, where it didn't matter what denomination you were. They came together to form a federation of believers that is today First Federated Church. Today, some things are still the same. The needs that brought that neighborhood together 100 years ago really haven't changed much, and First Federated is still here because of God's faithfulness, meeting those needs. 100 years your neighbor. Psalm 119:90. Your faithfulness continues throughout all generations.
Scripture reading this morning comes from the Old Testament book of Joshua. If you brought a Bible, you might want to turn there. Joshua chapter 1. These are the words that we find in that book. After the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, the Lord spoke to Joshua, Moses' assistant. "Moses, my servant, is dead. Therefore, the time has come for you to lead these people, the Israelites, across the Jordan River into the land that I am giving them. I promise you what I promised Moses. Wherever you set foot, you will be on land I have given you. No one will be able to stand against you as long as you live. For I will be with you as I was with Moses. I will not fail you or abandon you. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the instructions Moses gave you. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the right or to the left. Then you will be successful in everything you do. Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night so you will be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all you do. This is my command. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." These words that you have just heard were given by God to Joshua at a critical point in Israel's life. The era of Moses was past, and a brand new era that would be identified in Joshua was dawning. What began under Moses, the conquest and occupation of the promised land, was not yet complete. And it was time for Israel to move beyond what had been into what would be. You know, this is the way it seems that God has designed things to be. It matters not whether we are talking about a person or a family, a company, a church, or a nation. There are eras. In case my Southern draw is making you think I'm saying something I'm not. Era, a limited, measured point of time. They come and they go. Every era that comes and goes has with it its distinctive challenges, its victories, and its unfinished business. You know, during the era of Moses, Israel faced many challenges. They faced the challenge of slavery in Egypt, but they also enjoyed the victory of deliverance by God as His mighty hand came in and delivered them in a miraculous way, setting them free. During the era of Moses, they received in a positive way the revelation of God, the law, which would show them how God wanted them to live. But they also faced the challenge of disbelief, and they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. But now, at the juncture we're at in Joshua chapter 1, the era of Moses is over, and there's a brand new era on the horizon. And it's at this point of transition from one era to another that God elects to interject His faithfulness, the knowledge of His faithfulness to the leader of Israel and to the Israelites, to ensure them that just as He had been with them in the past, He would be with them in the future. Notice on the screen, looking at verse 3 again, "I promise you what I promised Moses. Wherever you set your foot, you will be on land that I have given you. No one will be able to stand against you as long as you live, for I will be with you as I was with Moses. I will not fail you or abandon you." And God was true to His word. He did not fail or abandon Joshua. He did not fail or abandon the Israelites. True to His word, God was faithful. There was the miraculous crossing of the Jordan River that we can read about. The unbelievable victory that was had with the heavily fortified city of of Jericho. And then there was the conquest of the Amorites and northern Canaan. And if we had time, we could go on in the list of the many things that God did to prove his faithfulness as he blessed Joshua and his people, the Israelites. But there were also the challenges, right? There was the defeat that they encountered at Ai. There was the failure with their neighbors, the Gibeonites. There was the massive unconquered territory that was still left on the table when Joshua's era was over. Yet despite all of the challenges, despite the failures, despite the successes, as in the Moses era, God was faithful in the Joshua era. Now you may be wondering, why, Pastor, have you taken us down this little road reminding us of God's work with his people Israel all those many years ago? Well, the reason I've done that is because just like them, we find ourselves, First Federated Church, at a transition point. We find ourselves moving into a new era. Not an era that is defined by the name of a leader or leaders, but an era that is defined by the passing of time, namely a century of time. Urbandale Federated Church, as you well know, was founded in June the 21st, 1914, by the Reverend W.J. Lockhart and 130 members of the community. What was it that motivated the founding of this church? What did its leaders back then, 100 years ago, see as the church's mission and vision? At the first anniversary of the church in 1915, Pastor Lockhart wrote about the vision that drove him and others in the community to found Urbandale Federated Church. On the screen is a quote from his writing on that day. Notice this. He writes, "For 9 years I have lived in this community, and through God's grace and favor have gone out to all parts of our country and seen thousands saved in Christ. But none of those thousands were my neighbors. None were companions of my children. Other communities I had seen turned to Christ. My own community remained unchurched. In the midst of a great meeting in a distant state, while seeing throngs come to Christ, there came God's call. I know it was his call. There is no doubt. And that is why I am bold to tell the story. It was a call to do or have done for my own community what I was seeing done where I was then working." You know, the mission back then was very clear. The mission was to lift up the name of Jesus Christ, to make the gospel known. The vision was compelling as well, to lift up the Lord Jesus Christ, to make the gospel known in a region of Iowa that today can be called 503-1011, the 1011 window, as we are calling it. In just a few moments, when we dismiss and you leave this auditorium, you can go out into the foyer, into the place that is known as the V. And out there, you will see a chronicling of our church's history, and you will see the many victories, the difficulties, the challenges that have already been spoken of publicly and that we're all so familiar with. You will see how the mission and vision was being carried out by the people who sought to obey the Lord and have faith in his calling. And through it all, whether positive or negative, whether in abundance or in lack, whether in love or in bitterness, the one constant you will see as you read the history of First Federated Church is that of God's faithfulness. You will see it over and over again. You will see God remaining. You will see God providing. You will see God strengthening. And that's been going on for 100 years, and it goes on right up until this very moment. And today we stand on a bridge, as it were. And as we stand on this transitional bridge between the century that has just gone by and the century that is coming our way, if we look behind us, we'll see that first 100 years flowing on. Folks, let me tell you something. As wonderful as it is to remember, as great as it is to celebrate, the 100 years that First Federated Church has lived and existed, it has gone under that bridge and it is off into eternity. It is never coming back. But if we turn and look in front of us, we see a brand new century. We see a brand new era. We see brand new challenges, brand new victories. And in those, we will find God's faithfulness remaining with us. As I stand on this bridge of transition myself, I see the clear mission and the compelling vision of the first 100 years. It is very evident. I see the strides that many of you were part of to see that mission and vision go forward. But I also see that we have unfinished business. I see that the work has not yet been completed. In fact, as I think back on the words of Reverend Lockhart, and he talked about his community, this community, being the most unchurched, it still remains. We just had a study done recently in which we discovered that within 1 mile of where we are, this very moment, is the highest unchurched population, unreached population in the Des Moines area. The work is not finished. There is still much to do. The community we're planted in has only grown in size and in scope. A brand new generation of neighbors have moved in. People of all walks of life. People of all races, of all tongues, of all tribes, of all languages are living right here in our ministry backyard. And they need to be reached out to. Church, let me tell you, the mission is the same. The mission has not changed. And the mission has not changed because the Word of God has not changed. The Word of God continues to teach us that we are to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, with all of our mind, with all of our soul, with all of our strength. We are to love our neighbor as ourselves, and we are to make disciples of all the nations. We break it down into 6 simple words so that it is easy to remember. We are here to love God, to love others, and to make disciples. And this morning, First Federated, I tell you that the vision is just as compelling today as it ever was in times past. It has evolved a little. We've come to see our vision as attached in 3 segments to those 3 aspects of our mission. But it's just as compelling. We have a vision for our church. A vision to nurture a scripturally centered culture of loving obedience to God that is demonstrated by a body of believers who are strong in dependent prayer, who are strong in faithful stewardship, who are strong in genuine compassion for one another, lifting up, ministering to, and caring for the body of Christ. We have a vision for our community to be a valued partner with the 10-11 window by strengthening families, encouraging education, and providing recreational opportunities that lead to open doors to redemptive relationships. I can't talk about it right now, but I'm so excited about plans that are being made and meetings that are taking place already to lead our church to be outwardly focused, to open up the facility that God has given us to be somewhat of a community center, to take opportunities of the tools God has put in our hands to reach into this local neighborhood and beyond and use and leverage what God has given us to impact their lives with the gospel of Jesus Christ through those redemptive relationships. And friends, we also have a vision for the kingdom of God. A vision to make disciples of Christ. Not disciples who just are looking forward to going to heaven, but disciples who are active, who are ambassadors of the gospel, who are developers of maturing Christ followers, and who are promoters of the local church. Today, on June the 22nd, 2014, First Federated Church enters a brand new era. And as we do, there are 3 things we can count on. Number one, there will be successes to rejoice in. I'm so looking forward to those. I'm so looking forward to God showing up and showing out, demonstrating His power, and allowing us to go along for the ride. There will be successes to rejoice in, but there will also be failures to learn from. It's just part of the human condition, isn't it? Until we leave this body and until we leave this earth to be in the presence of God forever, we're going to have those times where we bloody our nose on the concrete. It's unavoidable. So there will be successes to rejoice, there will be failures to learn from, but in all of it, God's enduring faithfulness can be counted on. God's enduring faithfulness can be counted on. First Federated Church, we have unfinished business. We have business that was started 100 years ago, and it is not yet complete. And so I ask you, today I ask you, will you join with me in the ongoing work that must be done? I ask you these specific points. Will you join me to ensure that First Federated Church remains a Bible-based, Christ-centered church? That is our heritage. It was founded on that. It has never wavered from that. And we want to keep it on that path. Amen? Will you join me to ensure that First Federated Church becomes community-focused? Oh, we've struggled with that a little bit now, haven't we? We've stayed Bible-based. What are you laughing at, Rick? We've stayed Bible-based and we've stayed Christ-centered, but we've struggled some. Hey, we are the generation that will ensure that First Federated Church becomes community-focused. Will you join me in that? Will you join me in a commitment to private and corporate prayer, to living and speaking the gospel of Jesus Christ, to faithful stewardship and support of this church in a financial way and its ministries and its missions organizations? Will you join me in living in community as the true body of Christ? If you will join me in that, will you stand to your feet right now? Will you stand to your feet as an indicator saying, Pastor Mike, I believe that is what God wants us to do. Pastor Mike, I will join with you as you join with me, as we join with God. And we will work to achieve these goals. We will work to advance the kingdom of God. We will work to advance the gospel of Jesus Christ to our community and our world. Yes, we're interested in seeing this work that God has founded continue to move forward. Will you join me in prayer? Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for what it represents. I thank you for the faithfulness that you have so generously lavished upon this body. God, for the work that you have done over the years, for the messages that have been preached, the counseling that's been done, the helps that have been done in the name of Jesus, both here and abroad, for the way that you have lifted up your name and glorified yourself by bringing men and women, boys and girls to saving faith in Jesus, the way that you have filled people with your spirit and used them in unique ways. God, we could stand here all day and all week recounting the numerous stories of your great works gone by. And while that is enjoyable and while that is helpful to a point and while it is encouraging, I know that you are saying to us, there is a work yet to be done. There is a community yet to be reached. There are souls yet to be saved. My name still must be lifted up. Oh God in heaven, I pray on this day, this 100th anniversary day, that you will bring healing to this church. I pray that you will bring forgiveness where it is needed. I pray you will bring encouragement where encouragement is needed. God, I pray that you will enhance the mission and the vision in our hearts and minds. And God, may we be eager and anxious to be on the ground floor, as it were, with this new era, the generation that continues on, the generation that carries you into this community, oh God. I pray that you would do whatever it takes to raise Federated in strength, in the power and might of your Spirit, to make a difference as she has in this 100 years gone by. Thank you for the faithful people, many of which are already with you. Thank you for the faithful people that are still here. Encourage them, strengthen them, help them, I pray. And Lord, as we move into this new era, may we see many new people becoming part of your family, calling you Lord and Savior, and First Federated Church as their home. Not for our pleasure, not for our grandizement, but Lord, for your glory. It is my prayer. See the commitment of these people standing now. Remind them of it often. Holy Spirit, propel us into the work that you have. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
It's been a great morning, amen. I'm reminded of a song by Martin Luther. Says, if we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. But in the great work God continues to want to do in and through this people and in this place, we have a great God who loves and cares about our community and who's going to show us the way. Let's go ahead and stand together as we close off this morning. Lord, we're so thankful for the faithfulness you've shown, for the people you've brought to lead us. We thank you that your vision will continue to propel us forward. Help us to be faithful in that in the days ahead. We ask in Jesus' name. You're the God of this city. You're the King of these people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. Greater things are yet to come, and greater things still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. To the rest.
Be the glory for 100 years. We'll see you again in 100 years. Let's do that again. You know, one way you can act upon the commitment that you stood to your feet to make is to get the word out this next weekend about what's coming in July. Vacation Bible School, designed specifically for those who are not yet part of First Federated Church and Christ's Kingdom. From 9 to noon next Saturday morning, we'll gather for breakfast and a brief word of instruction, and then we're going to cover as many of the homes in 50310 and 50311 as we possibly can. And speaking of 100 years ago, Do you know the population of those two zip codes is just slightly less than the entire population of Des Moines 100 years ago? The mandate remains. And in a creative, wonderful, warm, sort of way, had to invent a word there. But just by extending invitation. So if you haven't already signed up, please make it a point and join us next Saturday at 9 o'clock. And now what you're interested in is, when do we eat? So here's the instructions. If your children are in the nursery, please pick them up right away. And then you can proceed either to, especially families with small children, to the West Gym. Food, you can pick up your food there. There are activities for kiddos in the East Gym. Everyone else invited to Fellowship Hall. The rain has come and gone, but the ground is still fairly wet. You're welcome to find a place to eat, renew old friendships, and make some new ones. Hasn't this been great? Let's pray. Father, we're so grateful to you. Yes, for your faithfulness, for your presence, for your abiding, for all the miracles of transformed lives that have occurred because of the result of this ministry. We thank you for it, and we trust you to lay your hand of blessing on this fellowship for the next 100 years. And now we invite your blessing on the meal that we're about to partake. We thank you for opening your hand of goodness and reminding us that you'll take care of us even in the most simple and substantive ways of giving something for us to eat today, and for that, we are thankful. And now we bless you, and we praise you, and we thank you for these 100 years. And together, God's people said, amen. We'll see you on Saturday.